Intermittent cold exposure has become very popular in recent years, and for good reason. It increases testosterone and it activates brown adipose tissue that is loaded with mitochondria, and this can provide you with many benefits. It can help you burn calories and lose weight, and according to Dr. David Sinclair, author of the book Lifespan, Why We Age and Why We Don't Have To, intense intermittent cold exposure can even help prevent diseases like diabetes and Alzheimer's and possibly extend your life. This is because when the body is stressed by the cold, longevity genes are activated. At the very least, animals subjected to shivering cold for 3 hours a day are healthier and live longer, but you definitely don't want to overdo it. Yes, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, but do make sure it doesn't kill you. If you stay in freezing cold temperatures long enough, you will become hypothermic, something that is definitely not good for your health, but a little shivering is not to be feared. When it comes to cold exposure, there are many options. It can be as simple as taking a cold shower, sleeping without blankets on a particularly cold night, or taking a walk in the cold without a sweater to keep you warm. But there are other more interesting options. One not very painful one is to place a cold pack on the back of your neck and upper back for half an hour a day a couple times a week. Brown adipose tissue can be found in this area of the body, and according to Tim Ferriss, this is an effective and not very painful way to burn fat. And you can do this while watching TV, so it doesn't even have to be boring. Something that is more effective, but also a lot more unpleasant, is cryotherapy. In a cryotherapy session, you get into an enclosed chamber that quickly drops down to anywhere between negative 200 and 300 degrees Fahrenheit, and you stay there shivering and suffering for anywhere between 2 and 4 minutes. As I said, not the most pleasant experience, but the more you do it, the more you get used to it, and the benefits are unreal. It can help with muscle pain, arthritis, depression, and as I already said, it can help you lose weight, it increases testosterone, and it is likely to prolong your life. This takes me to the next thing I want to talk about, longevity. If you're watching this video, chances are you watched my second animated summary of the 4-Hour Body, where I talk about 3 very safe ways to probably extend your life: calorie restriction, donating blood, and if you're a man, semen retention. The thing is, I've realized that I didn't explain these 3 in as much detail in that video, so I'll correct that mistake here. Like cold exposure, calorie restriction without malnutrition stresses the body just enough for it to activate the longevity genes that slow down the aging process. The University of Wisconsin conducted a very long experiment where they separated 76 rhesus monkeys into 2 groups. The monkeys of one group were allowed to eat as much food as they wanted, while the monkeys of the second group were fed 30% less food, and those monkeys lived significantly longer. This is especially compelling because rhesus monkeys are our close genetic cousins, but pretty much every calorie-restricted organism lives longer. Everything from yeast cells to fruit flies to rodents, and there's even enough evidence showing that even humans live longer when calorie-restricted. The president of the Paris Medical Academy, Alexandre Guignot, who happened to die at the age of 102, was constantly calorie restricted. Also, back in the days when people were living a very long time in Okinawa, Japan, school children were consuming about 2/3 of the calories Japanese school children were consuming in mainland Japan. Okinawans even had a saying that reminded them to stop eating when they were 80% full, harahachibu. So no wonder Okinawans were thinner and healthier and were living significantly longer than in the rest of Japan and most other parts of the world. The problem with calorie restriction is that it's very unpleasant. Calorie-restricted monkeys live longer, but they're not the happiest monkeys. Calorie-restricted rodents are very aggressive. Luckily, there's an alternative that is as effective, but is a lot less unpleasant. Intermittent fasting. Animal studies show it works just as well as calorie restriction, and you are allowed to fully satisfy your hunger at least some of the time. People who do intermittent fasting regularly are thinner, have lower blood pressure, and also have lower levels of IGF-1, which is common among centenarians. In fact, IGF-1 levels are commonly used to predict how long someone will live. The higher they are, the less time they have to live. Like in Okinawa, in the Greek island of Icaria, people also live a very long time, and they happen to be Orthodox Christians that follow a religious calendar that calls for some manner of fasting almost half the year. The question is for how long you should fast. David Sinclair thinks that fasting for 16 hours a day is good enough, but in the 4-Hour Body, Tim Ferriss recommends fasting for 19 hours a day. Others like Dr. Peter Attia only eat 1 meal a day, and even fast for 3 days straight once a month. But of course, if you're new to fasting, be careful and start with shorter fasts. Let's move on to donating blood, which is a healthy thing to do because losing blood from time to time slows down the aging process by lowering iron levels. This improves insulin sensitivity, decreases the risk of heart attack, decreases the risk of developing Alzheimer's disease, and is likely to increase longevity. In fact, one of the reasons why women have longer life expectancies is because they lose a significant amount of blood every month during their period. They have lower iron levels than men because they bleed a lot more often. Once women reach menopause, their iron levels go up alongside their risk of getting a heart attack. In Denmark and Sweden, researchers noticed that healthy individuals who donated blood frequently lived significantly longer than healthy individuals who didn't. In one study, researchers fed iron to roundworms and discovered that iron caused them to age more quickly and decrease their lifespan. Also, David Sinclair has said that he is afraid of iron because iron-rich tissue is loaded with senescent cells, something that accelerates the aging process. Another very safe thing you can do to extend your life if you're a man is semen retention. In one experiment, one group of male roundworms was allowed to copulate with the females while a second group remained isolated from them for their entire lives. The isolated group lived significantly longer. As a human being, you're obviously a lot more complicated than a roundworm, but the genes and biochemical processes used by roundworms are the same as those used by humans, so ejaculate at your own risk. In the book Taoist Secrets of Love, Cultivating Male Sexual Energy, Mantak Chia talks about the importance of retaining your semen for energy and longevity, and he even says that if you do ejaculate, you should at the very least swallow your semen to conserve your energy and health. This might sound strange, but semen is in fact rich in a polyamine called spermidine, a compound that has proven to extend the life of animals, and polyamines are found in abundance among centenarians. They lower inflammation and promote autophagy, among other health benefits, so this just might be the reason why semen retention and perhaps eating your own semen is so healthy. Besides spermidine, there are other compounds and supplements that just might extend human life. In The 4-Hour Body, Tim Ferriss talks about a few, although he does mention that he doesn't try to extend his life with them because he isn't sure if they are entirely safe, but they're still worth talking about. One of these supplements is rapamycin, a compound that was discovered in the 60s right beneath one of the stone heads of Rapa Nui, most commonly known as Easter Island. In the 80s, scientists discovered that rapamycin could be used to suppress the immune system and prevent the bodies of transplant patients from rejecting the transplanted organ. But years later, scientists discovered that rapamycin could extend life. Having said that, transplant patients prescribed rapamycin don't live longer because taking it on a daily basis like they do doesn't increase longevity, but taking it intermittently just might. Rapamycin induces autophagy and inhibits mTOR, and it prolongs the life of yeast cells, fruit flies, and mice. It even works on old mice, which is fascinating because very few things can prolong the life of old organisms. Old rapamycin-fed mice live on average 9% longer if they are male, and 14% longer if they are female. Dr. Peter Attia has said that taking something between 2 and 6 milligrams of rapamycin once a week is likely to extend human life without as many negative side effects, and he has experimented with rapamycin on himself, but you definitely shouldn't. Rapamycin is only prescribed to transplant patients, and although there are many studies showing it can extend life, we don't know enough about its side effects and possible dangers when used intermittently for longevity. So for the time being, you'd be much better off looking for other less risky ways to extend your life. A safe alternative to rapamycin is protein restriction, as it also inhibits mTOR and induces autophagy. Obviously, this means limiting or completely avoiding animal products such as meat, fish, dairy, and eggs, but also beans and peas. This, however, doesn't mean you have to avoid these foods for the rest of your life and go vegan. Tim Ferriss likes to do this one day a week. According to him, one day a week of restricting protein could be enough to help you live longer, but doing it more often might not be such a bad idea. I say that because if you take a look at the regions with the longest lived people, Okinawa, Japan, Icaria, Greece, Loma Linda, California, Sardinia, Italy, and Nicoya, Costa Rica, one of the things they have in common is that they eat very little animal products. They eat mostly plants that don't have nearly as much protein as most animal products, and they have very long and healthy lives. In fact, according to Dr. Stephen Gundry, author of The Plant Paradox and The Longevity Paradox, who happened to live and work as a nutritionist in Loma Linda, California, the vegan Loma Linda residents are the ones who live the longest, followed by the lacto-ovo-vegetarians who only eat eggs and dairy, followed by the meat eaters. That, and multiple studies have demonstrated that heavily animal-based diets are associated with cancer risk and heart disease, so be mindful of the amount of animal products you consume as well as its quality. If you do eat meat, make sure it's 100% grass-fed. On the other hand, if you are vegan or vegetarian, but especially if you're vegan, get tested for deficiencies and take supplements if you need them. Some supplements you might need are vitamin B12, algae-derived omega-3 fatty acids containing both DHA and EPA, vitamin D3, and zinc. But again, don't take my word for it. Get a blood test. Another very interesting longevity supplement that Tim Ferriss mentions in The 4-Hour Body is resveratrol. Resveratrol is a natural compound that is found in small amounts in red wine and in Japanese knotweed. David Sinclair talks about it in his book, and he explains that resveratrol acts as a calorie restriction mimetic, and it has successfully and significantly extended the life of yeast cells, fruit flies, roundworms, and mice. Resveratrol protects the mice against cancer, heart disease, and neurodegenerative diseases, and in one experiment, obese mice that were fed resveratrol proved to have organs, arteries, and muscles that were as healthy as those of thin mice. Not only that, but these mice also had less inflammation, lower blood sugar levels, and more mitochondria than the control group, and they lived 20% longer. In another experiment, resveratrol was fed to human cells, and they were protected against DNA damage. There are two kinds of resveratrol supplements available, trans-resveratrol and cis-resveratrol. The one that has been used to extend the life of mice and other organisms is trans-resveratrol, but it quickly degrades into cis-resveratrol if it's hit by light, so one has to be careful with that. It's also important to take resveratrol with a high-fat food. David Sinclair has been taking about 1 gram of resveratrol every morning with a little bit of full-fat yogurt for over a decade because without fat, it isn't easily absorbed. With that said, I want to remind you that in The 4-Hour Body, Tim Ferriss says he doesn't take resveratrol to extend his life, and I'm not qualified to recommend it. So if you're considering it, do your research and definitely consult your doctor. This video is strictly for educational purposes. According to David Sinclair, resveratrol works by activating the sirtuin enzymes. The problem is that in order for resveratrol to work appropriately, one has to have youthful NAD levels because NAD is what fuels the sirtuins, while resveratrol acts as the accelerator pedal. NAD is a product of niacin, and we can't survive without it. Cells need it to produce energy, but as one gets older, NAD levels naturally decline. In fact, a 50-year-old has about half the levels of NAD as a 20-year-old. Scientists like David Sinclair are trying to find ways to increase NAD levels in humans, but there are currently 2 supplements available that may help with this. They're known as NAD boosters, and they are NMN, nicotinamide mononucleotide, and NR, nicotinamide riboside. They both work great on animals, but some experts don't think they work on humans, so for the time being, take this information with a grain of salt. And as I already said, do your own research and consult your doctor if you're considering either of these supplements. For more information on NAD boosters, resveratrol, fasting, and different ways to extend one's life, read Lifespan by David Sinclair. At the beginning of the video, I mentioned that one of the benefits of cold exposure was an increase in testosterone. I want to expand on that. Besides taking a cold shower, one of the things you can do to increase your testosterone is to eat 3 Brazil nuts a day. Brazil nuts are rich in selenium, which is linked to healthy testosterone levels and overall sexual health in men. But when I say eat 3, only eat 3. Tim Ferriss eats 3 Brazil nuts in the morning and 3 at night, but he says that is too much for most people. Don't do this unless you have a selenium deficiency, although he does recommend eating 4 Brazil nuts 4 hours before having sex. You may also want to supplement with vitamin D3, unless of course you already took a blood test and have optimal vitamin D levels. But I will assume that's not the case because vitamin D deficiency is very common, and low vitamin D levels are associated with low testosterone. But of course, vitamin D does so much more than increasing testosterone. It strengthens the immune system, and according to Dr. Stephen Gundry, it activates stem cells in the gut and promotes long telomeres. Telomeres shorten as we age, and studies show that the shortening of telomeres is correlated with the spreading of cancer and Alzheimer's disease. With that said, if you are going to supplement with vitamin D3, consider also taking vitamin K2 because these two work together in a very interesting way. Vitamin D3 helps the body absorb calcium efficiently, which strengthens our bones and teeth. But without vitamin K2, the calcium may end up in our arteries and other places where we don't want it. Vitamin K2 puts the calcium in our bones and teeth. As always, thank you so much for watching. Let me know your thoughts in the comment section below, leave a like, and don't forget to subscribe. Until next time.